Hello friends, I am Dr. Lakhvinder Singh, Assistant Professor, Department of Law, Punjab University, Chandigarh. I am giving presentation on the module Public Service Commission and Tribunals. Now in this module, the learners would be able to understand the working conditions of the Public Service Commission. Learners would also be able to analyze the political pressure on the chairman and members of the Public Service Commission. Learners would be able to understand the objectives of the tribunal system in India. Learners would enhance their knowledge with regard to the parts of the tribunals in India. Now let's start with the Public Service Commission. The Encyclopedia of Britannica, it defines the word civil service. It defines as the body of government officials who are employed in civil occupations that are neither political nor judicial. Now the public administrative system has ancient roots in India. During the Mughal period, the land revenue system was established. The East India Company was used civil services for their commercial purposes. During the British rule, such servants started working for the crown. The British government started the Indian civil service in order to strengthen their own British administration in the United Kingdom. But gradually, the Indian civil services were also directed to further India's interest. At present at the central level, we have the civil services, which includes all India's services, namely the Indian administrative services. Then we have the Indian forest services, then the Indian police services. Now there are various central services like the Indian income tax service, Indian railway services, etc. There are three tiers of administration: union government, state governments, and the local governments. The state governments have their own set of services. Now let's start with certain appointments, that how the appointment, qualification and the security of tenure for chairman and members of Public Service Commission will be done. Now since founding fathers of the Indian Constitution, they intended to set up an autonomous and independent, impartial and integral bodies like the Public Service Commission, both at the central and the state levels. The constitutional provisions protect civil servants from any kind of political and personal influence. The Indian Constitution secures the tenure of chairman and members of the Public Service Commission by providing for a strict judicial procedure for their suspension or removal. The Commission gives unbiased advice to the government on matters vitally affecting the morale of public services. So this is about the appointment, the qualification of the members of the Public Service Commission. Now Article 315 to Article 321. It provides and it basically deals with the establishment and composition of the commission as well as their consultative functions. Article 315 of the Indian Constitution is basically provides for separate public service commission for the union and the states. As we know that union have the Union Public Service Commission, and in the state we have a state public service commission. Article 315 clause 2. It further provides that two or more states, they may agree to have a joint public service commission for that group of states. This is also one of the provision. Then we have Article 316, and the chairman and other members of state public service commission are being appointed by the governor. So it's basically the mode of appointment, that how the members of the public service, union public service commission are being appointed, and the members of the state public service commission are being appointed. At the union level, obviously it is President of India which appoints them, and at the central level it is the governor of the state which appoints them. Despite this fact that their tenure of service is fixed, the chairman or member can be removed, and Article 317 of the Indian Constitution, it provides that the chairman or member of Public Service Commission can be removed with the Supreme Court's active involvement on the ground of misbehavior. Now this is very important, that Supreme Court's involvement is there, and it plays an active role in this whole process of inquiry. Whenever it can scrutinize whether they consider the relevant factors or whether they ignored the relevant factors while deciding their tenure or while removing any members of the service commission. So, but however, the constitution does not provide the procedure for appointing the chairman and members of Public Service Commission. In Mohinder Singh Gill versus Chief Election Commissioner, New Delhi, it's a case of 1978 in which The Supreme Court said that under Article 316 of the Indian Constitution, the governor of a state has also implied powers to lay down the procedure for appointment of chairman and members of the Public Service Commission. The Supreme Court said, they further declared that the High Court under Article 226 of the Indian Constitution cannot bypass this constitutional power of the governor and lay down the procedure for appointment of the chairman and other members of the Public Service Commission. In Ashok Kumar Yadav versus State of Haryana, Public Service Commission, Supreme Court said that the Public Service Commission should have competent, honest, independent and efficient persons who would not breach the public confidence. It is only the chairman and the members having such reputed character which who could make selections on the basis of merit. So, this judgment was very important in order to bring the transparency, accountability, independence, self-reliance of the institution. It is a very, very, very respected institution that it should comprised of reputed persons. Then there is a qualification for the chairman and the members of the Public Service Commission. The Supreme Court in Meher Singh Saini versus Meher Singh Saini, Chairman Haryana Public Service Commission 2010, the Supreme Court said that it is a function of the parliament. Function of the parliament to draw out the guidelines for qualification for the chairman and the members of the service commission, Public Service Commission. The Supreme Court said that the courts are not the appropriate bodies to draft guidelines regarding the qualifications for the appointments of the chairman and the members of the Public Service Commission under Article 316 of the Indian Constitution. Recently decided, the Supreme Court very famous judgment, that is of T.S.R. Subramanian versus Union of India, in which the Supreme Court was considered as an appropriate body to awake the government so that they would make reasonable guidelines on all issues of an efficient civil service system in India. In this case, the Supreme Court directed the center, state governments and the union territories to constitute their own civil service boards so that it can make recommendation on all transfers and postings. The court said that fixed tenure of bureaucrats brings professionalism, efficiency and good governance in the system. Most importantly, the Supreme Court held that the civil servant, they should not take and follow any verbal order from any executive authority or any member. They should act only on the written orders. This is very crucial judgment in this regard. The Supreme Court said that the civil servants must also be protected from any kind of arbitrary powers of administrative seniors and critical executive members. So, this was done in order to make the institution more accountable, more transparent, and there is a need which the court assumed that there is a need to strengthen this institution, and that is why they have recommended that there should be a fixation of tenure there on their postings, the transfers, the political members, they should not interfere in their actions, otherwise the whole function of the welfare state will be abolished, that will be defeated. Now, there is again in order to further strengthen the institution, there is a prohibition on the re-employment. Re-employment, Article 316, which provides for the ineligible for reappointment. A member of a Public Service Commission, he cannot be reappointed as a member to that office. Article 319D, it further prohibits a member of the Public Service Commission from taking employment under government. However, Article 319D, it also provides an exception. It expressly declares that on ceasing to hold the member of the Public Service Commission becomes eligible for the appointment of chairman of that commission. It is not being considered as reappointment, rather a fresh appointment. The time which a member spent in his earlier office will not be counted for the purpose of new office of the chairman. Therefore, the time period for the office of the chairman should be counted from the date when the member enters the office of chairman, and this was held in the case of State of Mysore versus R.V. Bidap 1973 judgment also. Now, there are certain functions and the functions of the public service commissions, and whether there is a need to consult with the public service commission in certain crucial matters. So, this is one of the issue. Now, we have article 320 of the Indian constitution, whose clause 1 provides that it is a duty of the union and the state public service commission to conduct examinations for the purpose of appointments to the services of the union or state. Under clause 2, the union public service commission is bound to assist the states in making scheme for various recruitments. The Supreme Court in UPSC versus Girish Jayanti Lal, it is a judgment of 2006, when the Supreme Court held that a regular appointment to a post under the state or union without issuing proper advertisement inviting applications from eligible candidates and without holding a proper selection where all eligible candidates get a fair chance to compete would violate the guarantee enshrined under Article 16 of the Indian Constitution. Now, this judgment is very important that the UPSC and the State Public Service Commissions, they should bring impartiality in the whole system in conducting the exams, because they are selecting, they are recruiting very efficient persons. So, the burden is upon them to adopt all the reasonable procedures, all the reasonable methods, so that the recruitment can be done properly. The Public Service Commission has power to cancel results of the examination under certain circumstances. Supreme Court in the case of Kumari Anamika Mishra versus UP Public Service Commission held that before cancelling any such result, the commission should have some strong and justified reasons. Of course, this is very important that the administrative authority action should have been taken on irrelevant things or they have ignored the relevant things for the purpose of judicial review of the administrative action. So, it is very important that the court should have this power, and they can exercise this power only when they have the justified reasons and they have the strong reasons. And moreover, in this case, in case there is no defect in the written examination and the sole objection was confined to the exclusion of a group of successful candidates in the written examination from the interview, the court found no justification in cancelling the written part of the recruitment examination. Then we have Article 320 Clause 3C, in which it provides that Union Public Service Commission shall be consulted on all disciplinary matters affecting a person serving under the Government of India in a civil capacity, including memorials and petitions relating to such matters. The proviso to Article 320 Clause 3, it provides that the President, as respects the All India Services and also as respects other services and posts in connection with the affairs of the Union, and the Governor as respects other services and posts in connection with the affairs of a state, may make regulations specifying the matters in which either generally or in any particular class of case or in any particular circumstances it shall not be necessary for a public service commission to be consulted. Now, whether Article 320 Clause 3C is mandatory or not, this is again very important issue. The question whether an expression used in a statutory provision is compulsory in nature or not has to be interpreted in its total context. And the mere expression that the word shall alone is not decisive of the matter. Similarly, the whole provision of Article 320 Clause 3 cannot be read in a mandatory way. Otherwise, any appointment made to the Public Service Commission in violation of Article 320 Clause 3C would adversely affect the innocent and faultless candidates. such injustice was not even imagined by the makers of the Indian Constitution. The Supreme Court of India, in the case of State of UP versus Manbodhan Lal Srivastava, 1957 judgment, said that the provisions of Article 320 Clause 3C of the Indian Constitution are not mandatory and they do not confer any rights on a public servant, so that the absence of consultation or any irregularity in consultation does not afford him a cause of action in a court of law. Another case was Union of India versus T.V. Patel. The Supreme Court held that the provision of Article 320 Clause 3C of the Indian Constitution are not mandatory. Again, it was reiterated in this case that it is not mandatory. The constitution makers envisaged that the consultation is not mandatory in certain class of cases. However, in the decision of the Union of India versus T.V. Patel had been held per incurium in the case of Union of India versus S.K. Kapoor 2011 judgment. In S.K. Kapoor's case, the Supreme Court opined that although Article 323C is not mandatory, if the authorities do consult the UPSC and rely on the report of the commission for taking disciplinary action, then the principles of natural justice required that a copy of the report must be supplied in advance to the employee concerned so that he may have an opportunity of rebuttal. Thus, the court viewed that the aforesaid decision in T.V. Patel's case was clearly distinguishable. Now, this was about the Public Service Commission and how the members and the chairmen are being appointed, how they perform, what kind of functions they perform, and in what capacity they are performing, and what is the necessity of the institution, and why this has been made for. So, it was for the, it is the Public Service Commission, Union as well as the State. Now, let us talk about certain the other part of this module, that is tribunals, the system of tribunals. Now, few centuries back, the state was only meant to protect law and order in the society and to protect its sovereignty from any internal or external aggression. The state assumed very limited functions. The state hardly bothered about individuals' interactions with each other. Even their fundamental rights were of least concern for the state. Eventually, it was not possible for the state to escape from their new responsibility. Therefore, that state made up its mind to enhance its functions so that all such serious issues should be tackled. For this, the state started making its regulatory presence in all spheres of the society, like education, industrial relations, transportation, welfare institutions, institutions of public services, etc. The state was aware of the fact that these functions require not bare modern legislations and executive authorities, but also the advanced modes of adjudication. The traditional measures of adjudication were totally incompetent to resolve modern, complex and technical nature of litigation. Such matters could not have been resolved in the traditional courts, which were already under the burden of a huge number of pending cases. So, therefore, the state devised new techniques of adjudication, including ADRs, like alternate dispute redressal mechanisms, resolutions, tribunals, special courts, etc. ADRs of many kinds, that is, we have nowadays mediation, arbitration, conciliation, by which they resolve the matter outside the main courts of law. And why it is so? Because the courts are very traditional in nature, they are very rigid in nature, they have to follow the rigid principles of CPC and CRPC and various other things. And the nature of litigation is very complex in nature and very technical in nature. So, they require the special attention, they require the special treatment, and definitely for that matter we need special courts, we need special tribunals, we need special arbitration methods. So for that matter, we have arbitration, mediation, conciliation. Then in the Gram Nyayalaya's purpose is again to provide the speedy justice and chief justice. Gram Nyayalaya's are their rule courts, which are being known as rule courts. These all are the ADRs, and all these special tribunals, all these ADRs, they have a same status as that of a decree of a civil court or any other court. And why this is for? This is for to give the authenticity and to give the more fruitness to the whole concept. That is to speedy justice, to chief justice, access to justice. Among all these adjudicatory bodies, tribunal is one of the most significant and efficient mode of resolving special matters. On the similar lines, almost all civilized states have adopted tribunals in their judicial system. They have created different tribunals for different subject matters like income tax tribunal, administrative tribunal, industrial tribunal, etc. The tribunals do have exclusive original jurisdiction over special matters. Usually, its decisions are final and not subject to judicial review. But in many countries like India, the decisions of tribunals are subject to judicial review. Because in India, judicial review is the basic feature of the Indian constitution, and no legislation can oust the jurisdiction of High Court or the Supreme Court under Article 226, 227 and Article 32 of the Indian constitution respectively. Now, in India, the first tribunal in the format of the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal was established in the year of 1941. Now, in the independent India, Article 323A and 323B were inserted into the Constitution of India in order to give constitutional recognition to the tribunals. The provisions were added by the Constitution 42nd Amendment Act 1976. The idea behind the adoption of tribunal system in India was very much clear, and it was to reduce the mounting arrears in high courts and to secure the speedy disposal of the service matters, revenue matters and certain other matters of special importance in the context of socio-economic development and progress. Obviously, India was growing, India was developing at that juncture, so such speedy justice was also required. That is also was the need of the hour. So tribunals are being constituted under a statute to decide disputes arising with reference to that particular statute, or to determine controversies arising out of any administrative law. Courts refer to civil courts, criminal courts and high courts. Tribunals can be either private tribunals like arbitral tribunals, as we have already discussed, or the tribunals constituted under the constitution, or tribunals authorized by the constitution, administrative tribunals under Article 323A, and the tribunals for other matters under Article 323B of the Indian constitution, or it may be statutory tribunals. Some tribunals are manned exclusively by judicial officers. Rent tribunals, motor accident claims tribunal, labor courts, industrial tribunals, obviously they deal with the special matters of industrial nature, in which they resolve the matters of the employer and the employee relationship. Similarly, if there is a rent tribunal, then it has been specially constituted for resolving the matters of the tenant and the landlords. Obviously, this is important that speedy justice would be provided in these special litigations, in these special circumstances. Then other statutory tribunals have judicial and technical members, administrative, like administrative tribunals, TDSAT, Competition Appellate Tribunal, Consumer Fora, Cyber Appellate Tribunal, etc. Presently, we are now seeing that we have Cyber Appellate Tribunals, we have State Information Commissions and different Information Commissions, Appellate Commissions, so which are dealing with the new things, in which the new kind of litigations are emerging, new kind of disputes are arising. Now, Article 323A, Clause 1 of the Indian Constitution, it empowers the Parliament to establish tribunals for the adjudication or trial by administrative tribunals of disputes and complaints with respect to recruitment and conditions of service of persons appointed to public services and posts in connection with the affairs of the union or of any state or any local or other authority within the territory of India. So, it basically deals with the service matters of the union and the state servants, government servants, central government servants and the state government servants. Then we have clause 2 of article 323A that which provides that a law made by a parliament under clause 1 may provide for the establishment of an administrative tribunal for the union and a separate administrative tribunal for each state or for two or more states. Specify the jurisdiction and powers and authority which may be exercised by such tribunals, which provide for the procedure to be followed by these tribunals and exclude the jurisdiction of all courts except the special jurisdiction of the Supreme Court under article 136, that is special leave petition. Now, in pursuance of article 323A of the Indian Constitution, the Parliament enacted the Administrative Tribunals Act 1995. The Administrative Tribunal Act was passed to provide for the adjudication or trial by administrative tribunals of disputes and complaints with respect to recruitment and conditions of service of persons appointed to public services and posts in connection with the affairs of the union or any state or any local or other authority within the territory of India or under the control of government of India. And Section 5 of Administrative Tribunal Act of 1985, which was constituted after this amendment, and it was legislated rather, it was enacted by the Parliament of India, that is Administrative Tribunals Act of 1985, whose Section 5 provides that the composition provides the composition of tribunals and benches. Each tribunal shall consist of a chairman and such member, such number of judicial and administrative members as the appropriate government may deem fit. So, it is for the appropriate government to select the number of judicial and the administrative members of the public of the tribunal, administrative tribunal. A bench shall consist of one judicial magistrate, judicial member and one administrative member. The qualification for a person to be appointed as chairman of the tribunal is that the person has been a judge of a high court or he has held the office of the vice chairman at least for a period of 2 years. In Sampath Kumar versus Union of India, the Supreme Court said that if the administrative tribunal is created in substitution of high court and the jurisdiction of the high court under articles 226 and 227 is taken away and vested in the administrative tribunal, the same independence from responsibility of executive pressure or influence must also be ensured to the chairman, vice chairman and members of the administrative tribunal. The court viewed that the appointment of chairman, vice chairman and administrative members must be done after consulting the Chief Justice of India. The court said that such consultation must be observed in a meaningful and effective manner. Finally, the court held that a person to be appointed as chairman should have been a judge of the high court or he should have at least for at least 2 years held office as vice chairman. A person who has merely held the post of secretary to the government of India and who has no legal and judicial experiences, if appointed chairman, would not only fail to inspire confidence in the public mind, but would also render the administrative tribunal a much less effective and efficacious mechanism than the high court. So, basically the Supreme Court wants special members, that the person should have the capability of knowing the legal part, and he has the legal capacity and the legal knowledge of the whole subject, only then he can be the chairman or the member of the administrative tribunal. Now, there is a case of L. Chandra Kumar versus Union of India, 1997 judgment, 7-judge bench, constitution bench of the Supreme Court, which held clause 2D of Article 323A and 3D of Article 323B. They held to the extent they empowered the parliament to exclude the jurisdiction of the high courts and the Supreme Court under Article 226, 227 and 32 of the Indian Constitution respectively as unconstitutional. The court held that the power of judicial review is the basic structure of the Indian Constitution. So, that cannot be amended or abrogated. These are the very basic structure of the Indian Constitution. The court held that all the decisions of tribunals, whether created pursuant to Article 323A or 323B of the Indian Constitution, will be subject to the High Court's writ jurisdiction under Article 226 and 227 of the Constitution before a division bench of the High Court, within whose territorial jurisdiction the particular tribunal falls. According to the court, this scrutiny will serve two purposes. Firstly, as the court said that the while saving the power of judicial review of legislative action vested in the high courts under Article 226, 227 of the Indian Constitution, it will ensure that frivolous claims are filtered out through the process of adjudication in the tribunal. Secondly, the high court will also have the benefit of a reasoned decision on merits, which will be of use to it in finally deciding the matter. The Supreme Court has also held that the tribunals have power to decide those matters in which constitutionality of the legislations has been challenged. In L. Chandra Kumar case, the Supreme Court also suggested that the tribunals may made subject to the supervisory jurisdiction of the high courts within whose territorial jurisdiction they fall. Relying on L. Chandra Kumar judgment, the Supreme Court in case of T. Sudhakar Prasad versus Government of Andhra Pradesh 2001 judgment, they further observed that the transfer of jurisdiction in specified matters from high courts to the administrative tribunal does not assign the administrative tribunals a status equivalent to that of the high court, nor does that mean that for the purpose of judicial review or judicial superintendence they cannot be subordinate to high court. High courts are the creatures of the constitution, and their judges hold constitutional office having been appointed under the constitution. Whereas the tribunals are the creatures of statute, and their members are statutory appointed and hold statutory office. Recently, the Supreme Court in Union of India versus R. Gandhi, President Madras Bar Association, 2010 judgment, Supreme Court held that the tribunal on whom court's jurisdictional power has been conferred should have members of same rank, capacity, and status as that of court. The doctrine of precedent is also applied in case of decisions given by the administrative tribunals. This is one of the, another feature which the administrative tribunals have. In S.I. Rupalal versus Lieutenant Governor 2000 judgment, the Supreme Court held that a coordinate bench of a court cannot pronounce judgment contrary to declaration of law made by another bench. It can only refer it to a larger bench if it disagrees with the earlier pronouncement. Furthermore, the tribunal has power to punish for contempt of itself, but such power is again subject to the jurisdiction of the High Court under Article 226 and 227 of the Indian Constitution. So, in this module, we discussed the powers and functions of the Public Service Commission and how their members are being appointed, and whether their consultation is necessary for crucial matters or not, which we have discussed. And moreover, we have discussed the recent judgment in which the Supreme Court has tried or endeavored to bring more transparency in the whole system and more accountability in the whole system of civil service. And they have said that the bureaucrats or the public servants, the civil servants, they should not act on the verbal orders, rather they should act on the written orders only. And the tenures of their service should be fixed, and the process of transferring them, their postings, they should be regulated. this has been recommended by the Honorable Supreme Court of India. And another thing which we have discussed in this module, that is of administrative tribunal. Administrative tribunal has been developed in order to provide speedy justice and in order to reduce the backlog of the cases which are pending before the different courts of law. So, this is administrative tribunal is very important in order to resolve or to address the new complex issues and new technical issues which cannot be resolved in the old or the traditional ways of adjudication. So, administrative tribunals are very important. Again, in this module we discussed that judicial review is the basic structure of the Indian constitution and which cannot be amended, and even administrative tribunals are under the control of the high court's jurisdiction under Article 226 and 227 of the Indian constitution. Thank you.